So in case you haven't heard of control theory before, the basic idea is this flow chart. There's some sort of stuff in the world we want to control, like maybe the cruise controller. You know, maybe you want to control the speed of your car via the cruise controller. There are some sensors on the wheels that measure how fast the car is going. Those are relayed to a controller, like your car computer, which runs an algorithm to figure out essentially if you want to go 70 miles an hour. The sensors say you're only going 60 miles an hour. There's a 10 mile an hour gap. And it uses essentially the gas pedal and the engine as a big old actuator to affect the real world. And so that's sort of the high level view of what control theory is all about. This is the canonical example in control theory. If you take ECE 147, you will spend a lot of time in a controls lab. there's this pendulum here that is being sort of driven by this little cart that moves back and forth, and eventually the idea is to stabilize it, get it upright, and then these kids can hit it and annoy the robot, and so far it hasn't retaliated. So that's sort of the canonical example. There's sensors in here that can tell the angle of the pendulum, there's the motor that can move it along the track, and of course the controller's job is to stabilize it. First swing, there's actually two controllers at work here. The first one just pumps energy into the pendulum, getting it swinging higher and higher. And then when the pendulum is close enough to the top, it switches over to a stabilization controller whose main goal is not to pump energy into it, but to just keep the angle very close to zero. We actually have a bunch of these setups. They're really expensive. They're more than 10 years old in the controls lab in Harold Frank Hall. So I don't get to leave Harold Frank Hall very much. I'm excited to be here. But if you ever want to come to Harold Frank Hall, come to the third floor and I'll give you a tour of the pendulums. And this is me a couple years ago playing with one of the pendulum setups. This is if you take ECE 147C, you'll spend a long time worrying about whether this pendulum is upright or not. This one actually has an interesting quality, which is that I have the controller try to balance it here, and then as fast as possible, go over here and balance it, subject to the constraint that you don't let it tip over. And then every once in a while, it'll go back over here. And there's something really cool. So it just goes back and forth, back and forth. So there's a set point for the cart position that changes over time. And there's something really magical. You can see that when it needs to go over here, the first thing that the pendulum does is actually the cart moves this way. Even though it's supposed to be over here, it'll kick back in the opposite direction in order to get the pendulum falling in the correct direction so that it can then sort of catch it and pick it up. And I did not, the magical thing about controls is that the students do not actually have to explicitly program that into the control algorithm. You just get that for free. Because of the math. That just falls out naturally. You plug in the dynamics and the robot learns that it has to go this way if it wants to go that way. I think that's just really cool. So where the overlap is with neuroscience, there's a lot of overlap, thanks Stella. But has anyone seen this video before? Okay, so some people have seen this video. This is a guy named Andrew Johnson. He's a 35-year-old New Zealander with Parkinson's disease. He has a neural implant. He has an electrode in his brain that uses, and there's a sort of a pacemaker under his clavicle that's connected to it. And it essentially injects a voltage into this part of his brain that at about 100 hertz. And for reasons that I'm not sure if people really fully understand, that seems to make the tremors associated with Parkinson's go away. So here he actually turns off, using a remote control, he turns off that voltage pulse, and he immediately begins shaking. And I'll fast forward it, but he essentially, you know, loses full control, motor control. He can't speak. His muscles are stiffening. It's very painful. But as soon as he turns on the pacemaker again and it begins injecting the voltage, everything goes back to normal for him. So this is like totally mind-blowing to me, that like you have this big complicated brain thing and you just start zapping it and suddenly it can make these the tremors go away. So as far as I know, and feel free to correct me on this, this DBS system does not use sensors implanted in the brain to figure out, you know, it just blindly applies a voltage signal. And so when a control engineer sees this, what a control engineer thinks is, well, I wonder if we could do any better if we actually had some sort of feedback, if we had some sort of sensors from the brain that were measuring the voltage, the spiking of the neurons or whatever. And that's precisely what a mechanical engineering professor at UCSB, Jeff Mollis, wanted to study. So he uses this Hodgkin's-Huxley model for neurons, and I don't know very much about it, but Jeff knows more about it. I'm sure you know even more about it. And so he sort of has a simulation here. So I guess that one of the theories for what's happening with these tremors in Parkinson's is that a bunch of neurons sort of get synchronized and they all sort of start firing all at once and they get kind of locked in this loop together. I don't know the details of this, but Jeff modeled this voltage, it modeled this effect. So here's a group of neurons. Here's the voltage that, you know, essentially when the neurons go over here, they're spiking. Let me get this going. And the y-axis is some other parameter of the model. So here's a bunch of coupled neurons that are all kind of spiking together. This is not the desired behavior that we want. So he said, listen, maybe if we knew the states of the neurons and we had like this model for how the neurons will spike around this limit cycle, maybe we could perturb them in some way that would disrupt them, that would make them not be firing synchronously. And so let me see if I can get the second video to line up here. So the idea is, When it's red, that's when he's applying this input voltage. And he's using it to disrupt the synchrony of the neurons. So they're not all firing all at once now. They're sort of a little bit more spread out around the circle. So I don't know I don't totally understand the details of this, but I'm happy to. I know Jeff really well, and if you want to talk to Jeff, I'd be happy to set up a meeting. But this seems like a really cool kind of overlap. So that was all sort of neuroscience and control theory. What do they have in common? But what I want to talk about is this Kalman filter. This is a tool that we use a lot in control theory, and I want to share it with you today. So essentially, the Kalman filter is the combination of a linear system and this algorithm called a linear recursive estimator. And those two things essentially comprise the Kalman filter. So we'll talk about these two things. A discrete time linear system is a set of matrix equations like this. So most people have taken linear systems, so I'll sort of breeze over this, but this is a vector. These are two vector equations. The x's, y's, and u's are all vectors of various sizes. The subscript I is some index, some time index that's a natural number, so 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. And the idea is that there's some sort of input, the u's, to this system. So u0 comes in, and at the same time, some output is measured, y0. The system has an internal state, these x's, that somehow capture the behavior of how the state will evolve over time. So u0 comes in, the system has some internal state, x0. x0 and u0, you combine them with these matrices A, B, C, and D. These matrices are constant, not time dependent. And that produces y0, what you will read out of your system. The x0 and u0 go in, and this ax plus bu combines to form x1. So this is going to be the state of the system in the next time step. Okay, so this is a very general model of a system, and you can use it to model all sorts of things. And I should say one thing about this is a discrete time linear system. There's also a continuous time linear system where instead of having all these i's here, you have essentially t as a real number. Instead of being a natural number, it's a real number. And instead of being a difference equation here, is a differential equation. It's sort of easier to understand the Kalman filter in terms of discrete time systems. And also if you're implementing this on a computer or something, that computer is going to be, I don't know, reading your sensors and changing your voltages at like, I don't know, a kilohertz, or there's going to be some sampling rate associated with implementing this on a computer. So for example, here's a DC motor. If you've ever gotten to play with these, they're really cute. You can get them for like $3. You apply a voltage, and that induces a current that goes through the motor windings, and the motor turns. And this theta I is the angle of the motor. If you want it, so this is a system. You apply some voltage, it turns. You want to know what's the angle. Maybe this motor is controlling like the stage of a microscope or something, and you want to move the stage over here. Well, how will you know where it is? Maybe you need some sort of encoder. So here is a rotary encoder. You jam a little nylon spur gear on the top that meshes with this one, and then these pins here, the voltages in these pins twiddle around as you rotate the encoder. And by paying attention to the voltages, you plug them into a computer, and you can decode what is the angle of the rotary encoder, which is essentially the angle of the shaft. Okay, so here's a whole system. You got the voltage that goes in, that's our VI. You get to measure the theta, the shaft angle, theta I. And then, of course, there's this question, what's A, B, C, D? Well, people have had linear systems here. I timed this talk a few times, and I just could not bring myself to have time to talk about all of it. So I will just have to say that for A and B, you use a process called system identification. The system identification requires looking up things about the motor specs, like what is the resistance of the motor windings, what is the inductance of the motor windings, what is the, you know, what is the various motor constants, and things like how many, you know, what's the gear ratio between this gear and that gear, and all this sort of boring stuff. And you write down like differential equations and then discretize them to turn them into a model. So I would love to talk more about it, and I made nice slides for it, but I just did not have time for it. But okay, so in the process of figuring out, writing down these differential equations and so on, it will be revealed to you that what are the, essentially the component, the states of this system. Well, inside here, there's, you know, some current that's going through the motor. The motor has some angle, and the motor has some angular velocity. That's this omega here. So when you figure out the A and B of the system, you'll figure out what the state of the system is. Okay, so we'll skip over that. We got your A and B, you're in good shape. Sorry about having to skip over the system ID part, but we have to for time. Let's talk about C and D, because those are actually kind of more important from a Kalman filter standpoint. Well, C and D are how you turn your state and your input into a measurement. And in this case, we're just measuring theta I. That's our one measurement. We have one sensor measuring one piece of the state. And so yi is just theta I. That's the thing we get to measure. So it's 001 times the state. So, okay, 001, you'll hit this vector here, you'll get this one thing. Is that clear? Does that seem all right? Okay, now, so C is this row vector and D is just the zero. Okay, now, if you had another sensor, okay, so C and D, we're great, we're in good shape. If you had another sensor that was maybe, this is a current sensor, so you put this in series with the motor, the current goes through it, you get to read the current, it uses like a Hall effect sensor which measures like magnetic blah blah. Then you have two sensors. So you don't have this measure, this is not your measurement equation anymore. You have now theta and the current that you're both measuring. And so now you have a different C and the state is just the same as it was before. Okay, cool. Now, if you have another sensor, maybe one that's measuring the angular velocity, like this funny little speedometer or something, then you're actually measuring all three states here. So this is actually your measurement, your output of the system is just the state of the system. It's just xi. And this is a very happy situation. You have a sensor for every state, you get to measure what's going on in the system, you have full knowledge, you get to look right into that state and right into that system and know everything. And when you are in this situation, you can apply a very special kind of a controller. So what I want to talk about now is controllers. So when you have, all right, I'm just going to talk extra for the fact that we're getting a little cropped here. That's okay, don't worry about it. So if you are measuring every component of your state, you can apply a very special kind of controller. But before we talk about that, let me just tell you about a controller in general. So this is a little like BeagleBone computer. Has anybody heard of a BeagleBone? Some people, no people, no people. The people in my lab. Say again? It's like a Raspberry Pi. Everybody heard of a Raspberry Pi? Yeah, exactly. So they both run Linux. They're pretty much entire desktop computers, but they fit in an Altoids tin is the thing. So your controller is going to decide, so this is UI here. The controller is going to decide UI as some function of YI. It's reading the output of the system. It's going to decide, so this is, you're deciding how hard to push on the gas as a function of, you know, the speed of the car, essentially. And when you are in a situation where you have access to the entire state, you can implement a so-called state feedback controller. That state feedback controller will have the form UI equals KXI. So this is just a linear, it's linear. This is just some matrix that you're going to multiply by the state, because if you have three sensors, you get the entire state going back. And just as an example, so if this state feedback controller, let me show you how it might work. So if K is 1, 0.01, and 0.2, and at time step 7, say, maybe the state of the system is you're cranking 0.1 amps through the motor. The motor is turning 90 degrees per second, so not very fast. And the angle at time step 7 is 10 degrees. Then what you would do to figure out what the voltage is that you should apply, the controller will just do this times this. So this is a 1 by 3 times a 3 by 1, so it's going to make a 1 by 1. It's just going to do 1 times 0.1 plus 0.01 times 90 and so on. You'll do that, and it's 3. You get 3 volts. So the controller is going to apply 3 volts when it reads this state. Okay, so that's a state feedback controller. And control engineers are very interested in knowing what K should I pick to make a good state feedback controller? The nice thing about state feedback controllers is they're easy to design, analyze, and implement. Why are they easy to implement? Well, because you just got to plug in three numbers. The controller just does a dot product every time it wants to run, and you're in good shape. Why are they easy to design and analyze? I won't go into the details, but what it comes down to is if you plug in UI equals KX into here, then you get AX plus BKX, and then you pull out the X's here, and you get A plus BK times X. And essentially what that means is, so the next state of the system is just some matrix, A plus BK, times the state. And so if you can arrange to choose a K so that A plus BK kind of goes to zero as you crank it up over and over, as you exponentiate it over and over again, that means that control law will stabilize the system. So that's sort of the short summary for why state feedback controllers are easy to analyze. Okay, but there's a problem. We needed three sensors to implement a state feedback controller. We needed to have access to the entire state of the system. Here's the situation. Here's my desk. I have a beagle bone. It's driving this DC motor through a little motor driver here. This DC motor is the same one that we were seeing pictures of before. It has the current, the angular velocity, and the angle. But I'm only using this little rotary encoder here. I don't have access to the current and the angular velocity. So I only have one measurement that I'm making here. And the measurement then goes through this stupid thing and goes back into the beagle bone. So I only have one sensor. You won't necessarily, I don't have a current sensor, I don't have an angular velocity sensor. You might not be in a position where you could instrument your system with all the states that you need. If you're designing a rocket or something, you might not be able to handle the weight of all of the system, of all of the sensors, that you would need to put around it, all the accelerometers and gyroscopes and so on. So anyway, so you're in a situation where you cannot implement a state feedback controller because you only have a single little tiny sensor. So what do you do? Well, maybe we could design an estimator. This estimator would take the measured output, this theta I here, and come up with a state estimate for what is the actual state of the system that it would then deliver to this controller. So the state feedback controller, this KI. Ah, we can see the U now, thank goodness. And then the normal, you would use just the regular old state feedback gain, K, that you had designed from before. So you design the state feedback controller pretending that you have full access to the system, even though you don't. And then you use this estimator to estimate the state and then pass that through. Is that clear? Okay. So here's an idea for an estimator. What if we come up with an initial best guess for where the system is? The system actually starts at x0. We'll come up with x hat 0, our estimate of where it starts at. And then every time step, we will just increment forward, we'll just time update our estimate according to the dynamics. Seems like a reasonable thing. We'll then propagate that, we'll then send that over to the controller. The controller will then use that to compute the control signal. The problem with this is that it does not actually use our sensors. It doesn't use any sensor values at all. It just picks some, initial value that hopefully is good and then just increments it blindly, sending it to the controller, and that's all it does. So you could actually implement this estimator with no outputs at all. Of course, that's not a good thing to do because as soon as there's any sort of model mismatch between, your model of the system and what it physically is, if you have any friction or noise or anything, you'll start to diverge, and then this won't be doing the right thing. So what we'll do instead, what we really should be doing, is augmenting this idea with this idea. Whenever you get a measurement, upon a measurement yi, update your estimated state with some rule, with something. We'll figure it out what. We'll figure out what in the next section. But whereas this was called a time update, because you're updating it according to the time dynamic, the dynamics of the system every time step, this is called a measurement update because you're updating the state estimate according to some measurement that comes in. And that's exactly what the Kalman filter, well, it's not exactly because I didn't tell you what this thing is, but that's basically what the Kalman filter is. It's an efficient algorithm for estimating the state of a system, like the state of a system, from noisy measurements. So we didn't get into the noise here, but we'll get to that in a second. But these noisy measurements are coming in here. The Kalman filter, when it needs to do a time update, will update its state estimate according to the dynamics. And when it gets a measurement, it will perform a measurement update. The single remaining question is, what happens in this ellipsis? How exactly will it do a measurement update? And that is the topic of the next section, the linear recursive estimator. So let me tell you what that's all about. The linear recursive estimator is it estimates a constant vector from noisy measurements. So here's the idea. This is somebody standing on a scale. Suppose we had a big freight scale here in the room, and we wanted to, say, measure all of our weights. We wanted to know the weight of everybody in the room. But the freight scale is meant for like big, heavy things, and it won't register if a single person gets on it. And so what we'll do is we'll actually have a whole bunch of people come and stand on it, like a subset of us, of all of us, will stand on it, and we'll write down who was standing on the scale and what the scale read. And then we'll switch it up. We'll have somebody, some other subset come and stand on it. Maybe some people will stay, other people will swap out, and you'll have some other people stand on it. Then you can make some other measurement of, you know, what this other subset of people weigh. And in that way, we will make a sequence of measurements, and each sequence of measurements will be measuring some linear combination of the things we really care about, our weights. So this is the idea. This is essentially what the freight scale is going to be weighing, what we'll be reporting. This matrix here will essentially be, for our example, a row vector of ones and zeros indicating which students were standing on the scale at that time step. This is the unknown constant. This is the vector of, I don't know, 15 people's weights that we're trying to figure out. And here's some noise that's like our crappy freight scale injects into things. So this is just a single, in this case, this is just a single scalar equation. But as we make more and more measurements, you'll get more and more yi's. So there's 15 people in the room, you make 100 measurements, this is 100 long vector, this is 100 by 15 matrix, and this is a 15 long vector. Okay, so that's sort of the problem set up for the linear recursive estimator. This is not a dynamical system, this is a constant vector, and we are making measurements, you know, repeated measurements over it. So here's the idea. This is just some math formality. So C is some matrix. In the sort of full-blown, general, beautiful thing, this doesn't have to be a single scalar. This could actually be a vector itself, but fine. So C is a matrix. R is the covariance of the random variable of the noise. And here's how the linear recursive estimator works. So there is a state estimate, x hat I, which is our estimate of this of the thing we're looking for, after I measurements. And here's the idea. Given some measurement, we would like to update our estimate from x hat I minus 1 to x hat I. But the key, the trick, is you're not allowed to store any of the previous measurements, and you're not allowed to store any of the previous state estimates except for the very last one. So it's sort of like we're doing these measurements, and everybody remembers their own weight, their own estimate of their weight. You don't know the true weight, but you remember your estimate of the weight, and you're not allowed to remember anything about what the previous freight, you know, what the previous scale said, and you're not allowed to remember anything else except your current estimate of your weight. And every time we do a little experiment, you know, that corresponds to some C matrix and some yi, and somebody, Stella, will report the what the scale reads, and everybody will say, ah, okay, and then you'll do a little calculation and update your own little estimate of your weight. But you're not allowed to remember anything in the past. That's why this algorithm is nice. It's actually nice that you do that because, well, okay, this is a recursive, that's why it's called the linear recursive estimator, because it's a recursive algorithm, and it's efficient. You don't have this problem where as you get more and more measurements, like you have to invert, you have to take like the pseudo inverse of like a huge matrix or something. You just have to remember one vector. Okay, so that's the setup. Let me tell you what is the algorithm for how this works. The update equation is a blend of the previous estimate and the innovations. So let me tell you what that's all about. When you get some new measurement, you update x hat I minus 1 like this. The new estimate is just the old estimate plus some correction term. This correction term, this thing, this quantity is called the innovations. And so this is the thing that you measured. Okay, so this is some number that you have, it's whatever the scale said. Ci x hat I minus 1. What this this is your previous estimate, and if that estimate were correct, if x hat I minus 1 equals x, if that was exactly our weights, then what you would measure is Ci x hat I minus 1 plus some noise. So Ci x hat I minus 1 would actually be equal to yi. If this was correct, this thing would equal yi, your measurement. In other words, if this estimate is correct, this will be zero. Then you won't change your previous update because your previous estimate because it was right. That seems like a nice property of an estimator. If there's some error, if this is non-zero, that means that what you were expecting to read and what you actually did read were not equal. Now you should probably make some sort of correction to your estimate. How big should that correction be? Well, it depends. It depends on stuff like how noisy was this measurement. If this was a very noisy measurement, then you probably this should be a small number. You shouldn't change your estimate very much because you're getting a lot of noisy measurements. Maybe you'd like to sort of average them over a while or something. So my point is that this sort of factor here, which essentially throttles how much your estimate will change as a function of some innovations, depends on stuff. Like your parameters of the problem, how much noise is there, and so on. We will pick this estimator gain to minimize this mean squared estimation error. So I also, when I was timing this talk, I did not have time to go into the details of exactly how how this is chosen. But what this looks like is this is the estimated the expected value of essentially your estimation error. How far off is your estimation of the state from the actual state. And it turns out that you can express this in some sort of complicated form that involves ki. So this, what you will get is, this is some complicated function of ki, and when you want to minimize something, as we all know from calculus, you take the derivative and set it equal to zero. And that's what essentially you do in this case too. This is some function of ki, take the derivative of it. Ki is a matrix, but you can still sort of, in a weird sense, you can take the derivative of it and set it equal to zero and solve for ki. And you'll get what the answer is, you'll get some sort of matrix. Ki will be equal to some matrix. So here it is. Okay, ready? The LRE algorithm, the linear recursive estimator algorithm, here it is. Your estimate of the vector you're looking for, and some covariance matrix, which is essentially the covariance of your state estimation error. This is what you're trying to estimate. This is your estimate. It's a random variable because this thing depends on the noise that you're suffering. So it has a covariance, and this is sort of a measure of how bad is your estimate at this point. When a measurement arrives, you compute the estimator gain. So here's some ugly equation that comes from taking the derivative and setting it equal to zero. This is the thing that you're keeping a running tally of. This is which students were standing on the scale. This thing is the transpose. So you're doing a lot of really gross matrix stuff. This is the covariance of the noise. So if it's very noisy, this is a very big matrix. Let me just point this out. If it's very noisy, if the scale's very noisy, this is a very big covariance. This is a big matrix. And so the inverse of this big matrix will be a very small matrix. So in other words, this K will be a very small matrix. In other words, if this is big, the estimator gain is small, and that means that you won't change your estimate very much when there are some innovations. So that's sort of a hand-wavy, intuitive feeling that maybe we're along the right track. But this is, nobody wakes up in the morning and thinks of this expression. This is like, this comes from a lot of smart people working hard. So once you have this estimator gain, you use it in exactly the way that we discussed, where essentially you multiply the innovations by this estimator gain, and then you update your covariance of the estimation error. So this weird thing that I didn't really have time to talk about, you have to update it. So your uncertainty in how bad your state estimate is will change a little bit as you run the algorithm. Okay, so I have an example that I hope will speak to you. It has to do with MRIs. It's an example of linear recursive estimation for image reconstruction from line integrals. So my sort of hand-wavy understanding of how an MRI works is that you have some patient. Please, let's have it be a two-dimensional patient so we don't have to deal with I can say pixel instead of voxel. How about, okay? So you have a two-dimensional patient. You're trying to measure the density of their head of every little pixel in their head. So their head is essentially composed of this grid of pixels here. There's an n by n grid, so there's like n squared little pixels. And you're going to try to measure this by shooting a little beam, like a little electromagnetic beam, through their head, and then hearing what is the intensity of the beam on the other side. In other words, this beam will go through certain pixels in their head, and the beam will be attenuated in accordance with how dense were these particular pixels. If there's a lot of density here, that's going to block a lot of the beam. So a model for what the beam here is as a function of the pixel density is this. The measurement that you make is essentially, is okay, let me talk us through this. L7 times X7. The idea is there's this little tiny distance here, and then there's some density, some average density in this pixel that is unknown that we're trying to identify. That will, this tiny integral times this thing is essentially how much the signal is attenuated because it went through this pixel here. The next term, L4 times X4, that's this line distance times this average density. That'll tell you how much was it attenuated because it went through this pixel. And there's an L5 X5 and an L2 X2 and so on. So the idea is what you read at the other end is a linear combination of the pixels that it went through. And you know, there's also a linear combination of the pixels that it didn't go through. Those are just, those coefficients are just zero. You know what I mean? Like the L1 for this is zero. Okay. So here's the idea. That's the idea. Every measurement, and you make a lot of measurements. Every measurement is a linear combination of the pixel densities of their head. And what you'd like to do is, given a whole bunch of these line integrals, each one, you know, the MRI machine knows where it's pointing the beam, so it knows the geometry, the line geometry, but it doesn't know the densities. Can you figure out the densities from enough lines? That's the idea. Okay. And so, just to put, sort of make it all mathy, the line integral, which is what you measure, is essentially a weighted sum of the pixel densities. This Lij has to do with the line geometry. This Lij is the length of the ith beam through the jth pixel. Okay, so that's, so if this is the first the beam that goes through, then this is L15, because that's the first line and the fifth pixel. Okay, fine. So it's a weighted sum of these things, and then there's some noise. So this is precisely what we need for the linear recursive estimator. You have some measurement that is some weighted sum of the thing that you're looking for, some constant thing you're looking for, and some noise. And maybe you know the noise covariance because you know about the machine. Okay, so that's precisely what you need to run the linear recursive estimator. I have a cute little simulation for you. Don't look at the answer. Okay, and the idea is, let's see, blah, blah, blah. And the idea is, as soon as you run, this is gonna work, right? Okay, and the idea is, let me see if I can rewind this, that'll be nice. Okay, here's a single line that goes through. Here's another line that goes through, so those pixels are all updated. You can see that when you add a new line, the pixels that the line didn't even go through are updated. So it's not like you need to hit you do need to hit every single pixel, but it's kind of weird that you can be updating pixels that the line didn't actually go through. That's because this line gets a little information about these pixels, and so these guys all get to be updated as a result. They all gain a little bit of information about what they should be because you learn a little bit more about these ones. Okay, so you do this more and more and more, blah, 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 and after like 1,200, you know, lines, you can learn the density of the patient's head. So if your head looks like this, please see a doctor. Okay. So, going back to the blah, blah, blah. Yes. You. Good. Okay. So this is pretty close to the true density, so that's nice. And in fact, I didn't mention this here, but this is, if you, instead of using the linear recursive estimator, something that you could always do is stack up all your measurements. You're getting a bunch of linear measurements. You get a bunch of linear measurements, and you have this matrix that you can build up, and then just take a normal like C / Y kind of thing. You know, like do a MATLAB pseudo inverse, and you would get essentially the same answer as this. The bonus of doing this is that you don't have to store a freaking giant matrix. It's very appealing. There are ways that you can do a pseudo inverse by doing like this thing called the rank one update. So that's an option. But anyway, I don't want to get into it, but there are some appealing properties of this over storing all of the measurements. Okay, so now we have the two tools needed to talk about what is the Kalman filter. And this is a very short section because we're just going to put them together. So This is a slide from before. The Kalman filter applies the linear recursive estimator to a discrete time linear system. So here's our system. I've added some noise now. This is like process noise. This is measurement noise. These are random variables with known covariances. And there, so the measurement noise is corrupting your output. The process noise is pushing around your state. Every time there's a new time estimate, time update, your state is getting pushed around by the process noise. And so here, this is the state that we left things, this measurement update. How are we going to do a measurement update when we get a new measurement? Well, obviously, we're going to use the linear recursive estimator. So all of this block is in here. So you initialize the Kalman filter with your best guess of the state. Here's your best guess. Here's the your guess of the uncertainty. So if you don't really, if you're not really confident in your guess, then this would be a big identity matrix. Otherwise, it'll be a small identity matrix, essentially. And whenever a new whenever there's a time update that you need to do, you just process, you just propagate the estimate forward according dynamics, and you also have to propagate forward your estimate of the your uncertainty forward. I didn't really have time to talk about the error covariance, so I'll skip that part. These equations are precisely from the linear recursive estimator. A new measurement comes in, compute an estimator gain, apply, you know, update your estimate according to the innovations, and then update your error covariance due to that new measurement that came in. So this is so that's the Kalman filter. There's something nice about the Kalman filter. There's a lot of nice things. One of them is the measurement updates and the time updates don't have to happen in lockstep. If you have a system that you are running a controller for at a kilohertz, but you only get, you know, but it has a measurement, it has a sensor on it that only produces a measurement once every 10 hertz. You can just run 10 times as many time updates as, and whenever a measurement update comes in, you can apply a measurement update. And there's a couple of subtleties, like, well, there's a couple of subtleties to that, but that's essentially a nice feature. These are kind of decoupled. Whenever a measurement update comes in fact, I worked at a company once, and we had an airplane that had a bunch of sensors on it, and it had a Kalman filter running as a state estimator for that airplane, and the measurements all had different rates at which they would be, they would come in. And every time a measurement came in, we would apply a measurement update that was specific for that measurement. And we, you can still, so you can actually have measurement updates that were, and so the C matrix is essentially the thing that would be different across all of the different kinds of measurements that you might make. So anyway, my point is, there are some nice ways that this is sort of decoupled, and it offers you a lot of flexibility in terms of not only in terms of the time updating, but also like the different kinds of measurements that you might make on a system. So here's an example of the Kalman filter. This is from the movie Mission Impossible 4, and you may not have realized that it had a Kalman filter in it. There. So when I saw this movie, I was really excited because I saw the Kalman filter. Well, I had to think about it a little while, but so this is, so okay, so the guy jumps off the building and he throws like a little device down on the ground and it's like an airbag, right? And then he lands on the airbag. It deploys just at the right time. There must have been a lot of really smart engineers who worked on that thing. Or it was maybe just movie magic. So a guy's flying through the air. He's thrown down this little airbag thing. The airbag, well, okay, so the guy has some position and some velocity. The airbag probably has some like LIDAR or something. Like the guy shouldn't have to land right on it. You know, like that would really harsh my mellow when I'm jumping off a building. So presumably the airbag can move back and forth somehow. It has some sort of actuation mechanism. And it probably, in order to know where to move, probably has some sort of sensor that can provide maybe a noisy estimate of the guy's position. It doesn't get to measure his velocity. That's too nice. It just has, you know, sort of a LIDAR type thing that can measure his position. Okay? And then the little airbag can form an estimate of where this guy's position is, and it can also form an estimate of what his velocity is. This is not a very good estimate, right? It's pretty far away from where the guy actually is. But based on that, and this is maybe an uncertainty ellipse for where the guy is, and based on that estimate of his position and velocity, the airbag can figure out, can just essentially run the system, can, you know, look at the ballistic trajectory and figure out where the guy is probably going to land. And then the airbag will hopefully kind of scoot over there and be able to catch him. And so then he'll make another, you know, he'll sweep the guy again, he'll get another sensor, get another estimate, and hopefully go there. So I'm sure the people who made this movie ran extensive simulations, which I have I contacted them and got their simulations, which I have to share with you here. Okay, so let me see if my little pointer can work. No, okay. Let me see if this little thing can work. No, okay, good. So, how about this? Yeah? Yeah. So here's the building. Here's a zoom in of the building. You can see the scale here. It's just a, like, we're zoomed in just like to right here. Okay, here's the guy. Let's see, you can't really see the little airbag yet. And the little estimate is also off the screen. So let me run this a few time steps. Now I set up the simulation so that the little airbag does not get a measurement every time step. So the time steps occur much faster than the little airbag makes a measurement. And so, you know, okay, so here are the guys, you know, jumping off the building, and at some point there's gonna be a measurement that comes in. Now, there was an initial estimate of where the guy was, and it was just sort of a random guess. It was in the middle of the building, which is obviously wrong. But as soon as a measurement comes in, the little airbag can essentially run a measurement update of the Kalman filter and get a new estimate for where the guy actually is. And it'll be a fusion of what the previous estimate was and the measurement that comes in. Okay, so we'll run it a little bit more, because so then it can show up nice and big on this screen. So here's another measurement update that comes in, and now the state estimate has now moved closer to the measurement update. It's essentially, you know, a fusion of the previous measurement, of the previous estimate, and the measurement that came in. Now, there's something interesting to note here. Here are some time steps that are occurring where there's not a measurement that comes in, and you can see that this ellipse gets bigger. What's happening here is, essentially, the airbag is doing time updates, and this is the error covariance ellipsoid. The airbag is saying, essentially, I haven't gotten any measurements for a while, so I actually don't really know where this guy could be. And so that's what's happening. That's why that error ellipse is getting bigger. Okay, so then another estimate comes in, and now the error ellipse, you know, has shrunk a little bit because you got a measurement update, and has moved closer to the thing. So, okay, I'll just run this. So blah, 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 blah. Another estimate comes in, and it looks better. And I'll just run this at full speed. So here he is, falling, falling, falling. You're getting more and more updates. I hope he lands on the thing. Oh, whew, okay. This is the cushion, obviously. He landed on the cushion. It was kind of a close thing. Obviously, I had to twiddle the... I mean, this is like only a meter, you know? So that's like pretty reasonable for landing on a magic airbag. Okay. So anyway, we're going to have to see this again because it's part of the keynote presentation, or cover out of the keynote as well. So you'll get another chance to see it. Okay. So here is, you can see the little red ellipse is growing, growing, growing between measurement updates.
Would you say the filter is Markovian?
Oh, I don't know what that means.
Like that only depends on the previous state, right?
Oh, yes.
Or the current state if you wish. So.
That's right, yeah. The it only depends on the, you know, current estimate, yeah, of the state. That's right. So that's the end of the talk. Thanks.
Question. Mm. So, in order for this jumping off the building thing to work appropriately, I have to pick a correct measurement, an estimation window, right? Do you see what I'm saying? Like, let's say if my time of measurement is when he jumps and then he's shortly before the ground, it's already too late.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I mean, there is a way to set it up so it can't catch him. That's right.
How, if I, so I need a system model in order to pick good limits on these timings, right?
Yes, the system model that's in use here is merely the sort of ballistic trajectory. You know, like there's gravity, and other than that, it's free fall. Yeah, but to address your question, like, you know, aside from that model, there's also, so okay, there is definitely the designer is designing the airbag. Hopefully put into account the fact that, you know, how good do we need the error covariance of the measurement to be in order to get a pretty good estimate, you know, given that we're going to get, I don't know, 20 measurement updates before he hits the ground or something. So, yeah, so you're absolutely right. There's a relationship between what's the covariance of this thing and how many measurement updates will we get. And how long do we need to wait? In fact, I think if you look, there is like a steady state there is like a steady state size of the uncertainty ellipsoid. You can see that it kind of gets smaller and smaller. It never gets to zero because, and that's kind of a function of the process noise, the process covariance. But yeah, so hopefully, I mean, really, this should have been at least as big as the, you know, as the uncertainty ellipse. Cool.
Sweet, man.
Thanks, folks. Yeah.
What's a case where you wouldn't want to use the Kalman filter?
Yeah, so there's a lot of extent, so there's a lot of places where it, just using a stock Kalman filter won't work very well, and you'll need to use one of the exotic extensions of the Kalman filter. So for example, like if you have a discrete time nonlinear system, one thing that you can do is use this thing called the extended Kalman filter, and essentially all you do in that case is when you do a time update, you do update your state. You update your state in accordance with the nonlinear system. But when you want to do like a measurement update, I think you essentially have to linearize your system around your current estimating, around your current state estimate, and then do your matrices with that thing. Yeah, and then like Still and I were talking about before the talk, like there's this thing called the unscented Kalman filter, which has to do with like, I think the Kalman filter assumes like a Gaussian noise distribution on your process and measurement noise. And if that's not the case, it'll still work pretty well, but if you want to be fancy about it, you can use this thing called an unscented Kalman filter, where in addition to your state estimate, you also keep these sort of these things called sigma points. You also are sort of estimating these points kind of around the state estimate that whose distance from the state estimate have to do with essentially the error covariance that is influenced by your possibly non-Gaussian process noise or measurement noise. So anyway, there's this thing called the unscented Kalman filter that you use where you have to do a little more work to account for the fact that you might be having non-Gaussian measurement noise. Yeah, and then there's this other thing called the, I can't remember the name of this other Kalman filter, but there's this thing called the particle filter, which where essentially you just throw computational horsepower at the problem. You have a whole bunch of particles that you use as your state estimates, and you're doing time updates of these particles. And then when a measurement comes in, that measurement essentially is incompatible with certain particles in your system. So you don't know where your state is. It could be in a lot of places. You have a bunch of particles that represent places your state could be. And then when a measurement comes in, that measurement sort of disproves a certain set of particles, because those measurements would not get the measurement that you did if your state were those particles. Does that make sense? So you can then throw away those particles, and so essentially add a bunch more particles in a more probable region that is compatible with the measurement, and then run the system, do time updates on that until another measurement comes in. So that's the elevator pitch for the particle filter. Yeah. Sherrod.
So did you find, when you're doing research, did you find any examples of researchers using filtering for neuroscience problems?
Oh, I mean, I haven't, I mean, I'm going to push that back to you guys. I don't know very much about the neuroscience literature, so I can't speak to that part of it, but it seems, I mean, the Kalman filter is a very common, is a common tool used for in our field.
Yeah, yeah. So essentially you use it for predictor corrector systems, right? And so what does our brain do? It makes a model of the world and tries to make predictions that interact with the world and make updates. So essentially, there's a big analogy that's going on between processes in the brain and what this Kalman filter is describing.
Okay, so it's kind of being used as maybe a model of what the brain might be doing.
Yeah, you could potentially apply it to certain processes in the brain. However, the thing that is very, very tricky in the brain is that the data that we have, especially specifically from humans, is usually non-invasive data, which makes it extremely noisy. And we are making indirect measurements of actual, and then infer processes from this indirect measurement. So you have a lot of potential for noise, which makes it such a difficult problem. You have a lot of noise in a complex system, and you know, it's very, very easy to get lost. So the question about what is the correct time window, what's the correct sampling rate, how far should we zoom in, those are really, really essential questions that we have to figure out before, you know, we're trying to utilize such wonderful tools that can
come. Sounds like an exciting area.
Yeah, it is.
Totally. But hard, too.
Well, I mean, you don't expect that you're going to, you know, build an airplane that's going to fly appropriately. You know what I'm saying?
We'll leave that for deep mind. Cool. Thanks, folks.
Thank you so much.